Hi, and welcome to another video. In this video, I'll respond to an objection against Christianity. Luke chapter 2, verse 52 says, "And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men." This verse of scripture is the basis for one of the objections raised by those who reject the divinity of Jesus Christ, whether it's Muslims or other disbelievers. They claim that if Jesus is the all-knowing one true God in flesh, then he could not increase in wisdom. First of all, I think it's important to mention that the Bible does declare Jesus possesses the divine attribute of omniscience. For example, in Mark chapter 2 verse 8, he knew people's thoughts. In John chapter 6 verse 64, he was able to distinguish true believers from non-believers, and he knew from the beginning Judas would betray him. While in John chapter 16 verse 30, he in fact knew all things. So how can Jesus increase in wisdom if he is the one true God who knows all things? Well, let's look at the context of Luke chapter 2, verse 52. The verse right before that provides us with insight. It says, quote, "Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was obedient to them. But his mother kept all these words in her heart," end quote. So Jesus here in this context is subject or obedient to his parents. Then, as we saw already, the next verse says, quote, "And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men," end quote. In other words, Jesus increased in wisdom within a context dealing with learning obedience to his parents and interacting with men. So here's how I will respond to the objection. Think deep about this for a second. Even though Jesus is God in flesh as a man, it was not a common everyday experience for God to obey his own creation. However, in this case, he did exactly that. But notice it was not God as God, rather it was God in his flesh mode of existence as the man Jesus Christ, who was obeying Mary and Joseph. It therefore can be said that he increased or grew in wisdom in this specific context, in his functionally human experience. But let me articulate this in a better way to avoid any confusion that may enter your mind. Let's look at the original Greek word used for wisdom in this verse. The Greek word used here is sophia.
Its various definitions are wisdom, broad and full of intelligence, used of the knowledge of very diverse matters, the wisdom which belongs to men, the varied knowledge of things human and divine, acquired by acuteness and experience, the science and learning, the act of interpreting dreams and always giving the sagest advice, skill in the management of affairs, a devout and proper prudence in contact with men not disciples of Christ, skill and discretion in imparting Christian truth, and acquaintance with divine things and human duties, etc. So, as we see from the list of definitions, there are many aspects of wisdom.
These aspects were known in the Greco-Roman world when Luke's record of the gospel was written. Luke himself was a Greek from Antioch, Syria, and the Greeks were known for distinguishing between a few types of wisdom.
For example, in Aristotle's Nicomachean Ethics, Sophia is associated with contemplative and theoretical reasoning about universal truths. Another type of wisdom, known as episteme, from which we get the word epistemology, which is often included under Sophia, refers to universal knowledge or scientific information. An example would be the concept of gravity. Another type of wisdom is known as techne. This is technical knowledge dealing with the mechanics of process. An example would be learning a craft, like learning how to make a basket from raw materials, etc. And finally, another type of wisdom is known as phronesis. This is practical wisdom. It stresses the ability to not only contemplate rationally about universal truths, but to consciously make decisions that promote a good life in practical, diverse life situations. So whereas Sophia is abstract wisdom, phronesis is the practical application of that abstract wisdom in daily life situations. In other words, it's like asking yourself, what is the wise decision to make in different interactions with people? Would it be wise to do this or that?
So from all these different aspects of wisdom or Sophia, we must ask ourselves, which aspect of wisdom did Jesus grow in? We must identify this in order to understand the text of Luke chapter 2, verse 52.
Remember, Luke chapter 2, verse 52 says, Jesus increased in wisdom within a context dealing with learning obedience to his parents and interacting with men. So we are not dealing with the aspect of wisdom or Sophia, which is understood to be a reflection on universal truths. Nor are we dealing with the aspect of wisdom known as episteme, which is understood to be universal knowledge or scientific information. Nor are we dealing with the aspect of wisdom known as techne, which is understood to be technical knowledge. No, in this context, we are dealing with the functionally human experiences of Jesus in dealing with his parents and other human beings. In other words, we are dealing with the aspect of wisdom known as phronesis, which, as I said, is understood to be about practical, everyday human wisdom. So what Luke is saying here is that God negotiated new experiences through his new flesh mode of existence in and as the man Jesus Christ. This makes sense because, as I already mentioned, it was not a common everyday experience for God to obey his own creation, in this case, obeying Mary and Joseph. But because it was a new experience for God to be in flesh as the man Jesus Christ, he thus negotiated or navigated through those new experiences, thus growing in a practical, everyday human wisdom, not in his divine wisdom.
So it can be said, Jesus did grow in that kind of experience.
The idea that the sovereign God of all creation, who has always been accustomed to issuing commandments, who submits to no one else, became flesh as Jesus, and as a boy grew up in a human environment and had to submit to Jewish parents and to the Jewish elders and the man-made laws of that society, might seem like an absurdity to some. But the Bible says God became or put on flesh, and that fact is in itself a lowering or state of humiliation. So it would seem appropriate, therefore, in that state of humiliation, for Jesus to grow in human wisdom as he negotiated or navigated through those new experiences. This idea is emphasized also in Hebrews chapter 5, verse 8, which says, quote, though he was a son, yet he learned obedience by the things which he suffered, end quote. And by doing that, Jesus showed solidarity with us humans in obedience and righteousness through his actions.
So, in summary, my response to the objection is, Jesus did not grow in divine wisdom, because as God, he already possesses all divine wisdom. And I already showed from
Mark chapter 2 verse 8, John chapter 6 verse 64, and chapter 16 verse 30, he clearly does possess the divine attribute of omniscience. Rather, Jesus only grew in the aspect of wisdom known as phronesis, a practical, everyday human wisdom.
Finally, I hope this video has been a blessing for you.
I end with 1 Timothy 3:16, quote, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory, end quote.
Thanks for watching, and God bless you.